Hello, everybody. Welcome to Sapo Saturdays Scratch Track Sessions. You got your boy ASAP Froggy, the one, the only, Bingus Frog. And we are coming to you live from the art department in West Hollywood, California. It's a little rainy, but that's okay. And we are stoked to have an in-house guest today.
That is
welcome,
right.
Welcome.
Yeah. Doesn't matter that it's raining and it's gloomy. We're going to bring a little light to your lives today. Thank you so much for being here. We are Sapo Studios. Our goal is to bring the majority of profits and ownership rights back into the hands of artists. We operate under the umbrella of the Notorious Frog NFT Project, a.k.a. Frogland. Do your own research, but get involved. We have plans to continue coming here every Saturday, as long as we have breath in our bodies, live on Twitter at 12 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, now known as X. And we came in a little early today to accommodate the one, the only, Justin Shenkarow. How are you?
What's happening? Saturday in L.A. We got a little rain. And I just got to throw out, it's Saturday, we got to throw out a little Hey Arnold, if that's okay.
That's right. Hey Arnold.
Hey Arnold. What's up, everybody? It's Harold from Hey Arnold giving you some love on a Saturday.
Super cool. I love
that. That is awesome,
man. We came and filmed a podcast for you the other day, and the energy that you and your co-host brought was just like, it was awesome. I mean, and that's what you want for a show. You want people that want to be there, and you can tell that like you are there like to show up and perform and be present and in the moment, and that's really great, man.
Well, I appreciate that. Thank you. We have a blast doing it, and thank you guys for filming us, for editing it, for putting this whole thing together. I want to shout out to Greg and Keith, the whole art department, the whole staff. This is where community lives and breathes. And you guys, with your residency here every Saturday, get down to the art department, meet the Davids. They're doing it. Go check out Frogland. This is where it's at. This is where community is built.
That's right. And we're so happy to have you as part of the crew now. I understand you're going to be doing some more podcasts out of this location, which, I mean, to have great emerging artists come to this space, that's what we want. And
that's what the whole thing is about with the art department. We were lucky to watch, you know, like, and it was quite entertaining. Man, you and your partner.
Quite, yeah, it was.
Thank great. You, thank
it,
you.
It
we
was kind of like a masterclass. It was cool. And so you know, our goal, as you heard in my spiel, is to bring profits and ownership rights back into the hands of artists. We're still trying to navigate our way into how to do that because you know the NFT market kind of plummeted a little bit.
Yep.
And we were going to do some things with respect to that, and we're trying to figure some things out. I think we have some good game plans. But when I was listening to your podcast, you were talking about the book, which is right behind you, Future of Community, which you are responsible for co-writing. And I want to hear a little bit more about what the book is about and what your initiatives are, because it sounds like they somewhat line up with some of the initiatives we have here.
Amazing, amazing. Well, first of all, I love your intro because I didn't realize that that was a big part of your initiative, which is bringing rights to creators and empowering us all. And it's actually fascinating because when you were opening the door, I was just getting off the phone with a very good friend of mine who's a fantastic producer. And we were just kind of a little bit commiserating over the fact that, you know, studios and networks forever have never given us as talent, whether you're an actor, you're a writer, you're a director, even crew, anybody who's actually working on a film or TV show, we've never gotten a sliver of the pie. Never.
That's
never,
right.
Never, never. Now, some of the A-list, they get some of that, right? But for the folks who are just, you know, underneath them, who are just grateful to work, we've never gotten that. And that's why we're so passionate about Web3 and NFTs, because we're shaking up the market. We're revolutionists in terms of the fact that we want to demand that we should get some piece. You know, that's what we deserve.
It's only fair.
It's only fair.
That's the biggest thing that what clicked for us in when we started doing this with NFTs was that the artists and whoever creates anything to do with art, whether it be movies, writing, television, is connected to that commodity. As soon as it's purchased,
music, painting, sculpture,
anything,
all of the
anything,
arts, yeah.
Ticket buying, whatever that yeah. is for the artist that's performing at a venue. Being connected to the smart contract throughout, and as soon as the commodity is purchased, those people get paid.
Yeah, the money is immediately disseminated. As we've spoken about before, there's no men in rooms deciding how this money gets divvied up or
insane.
When.
And that's
it's
why,
insane.
That's why the whole strike took place in the
right.
first place was, you know, these The money goes to the room, and then is like I'm freelance,
mm-hmm.
so like I work a lot and I'm waiting for the man to pay me all the time.
Exactly.
And it sucks, and it's like, but the thing's already been done. It's already
right.
been purchased. It's already been shown. Whatever that is like
those corporations need to get on board with what's happening, because it's the future of technology. It's not going to go anywhere.
Now, yeah. you've alluded to the fact in the interview that I watched that kind of the book and some of the sentiment behind what you're pushing towards is this unionization for these freelancers, for these creatives. And what I wonder is, it sounds like a great initiative, but the minute you unionize something, it sounds like you're moving more towards that corporate world that the NFTs were designed to get away from. So if you can talk a little bit about striating that line and what that looks like.
Great point. And also, thanks for bringing up the book, Future of Community.
I'm looking forward to reading it.
Oh, it's really fun. We got this great deal with Wiley, which is a, you know, wonderful world-class publisher. They reached out because we had done a podcast like you guys. We did 100 episodes of a show called NFT Heat.
100 episodes. 100, that's very impressive.
It was. Well, yeah. I'll tell you what's funny. So John, who I don't know if we told the story. So we met at the Soho House in downtown like in 2021. Early. He was in the pool and I was having a cocktail. You know, Saturdays for cocktails.
That's right. And, shout out to Lago.
And he's talking to some guy in the pool about NFTs, and my ears went up because at the time I had just done a hackathon with Ethereum Global because I heard about NFTs and I was kind of starting to incubate like an idea about how I wanted to get into this space. And I hear NFTs and I'm like, dude, you're doing NFTs? Like, nobody was talking about NFTs in early 2021.
Right.
And he's like, yeah, I'm working for this Mark Cuban, you know, Ashton Kutcher-backed company, and I'm trying to figure it out. So we just hit it off right away. We became really good friends, and we were like, let's do a podcast together and bring on some thought leaders. So then we, you know, we get this opportunity to write this book. We write it in 3 months because they're like, you know, it has to be out in December. We're like, oh, my gosh. And it's overwhelming. It's terrifying. Initially, I thought, oh, this is going to be easy. I've been in NFTs for 3 years, Web3. I know all this stuff. Like, I love it. I'm passionate about it. We got the chapters in mind. And then you actually start writing and you're like, oh, I already wrote that. No, I have to change that. It has to be funny too. You have to tell a story. Oh my God. It was so overwhelming.
As a host, you know, that's almost like navigating an interview.
Exactly.
You know,
it really is.
And filling out that time, making it entertaining.
Yes.
Finding a way to keep people engaged. So,
right.
Yeah,
it's a lot of work. It was stressful, but we're so happy with the end product. We love it. And the book is, it's meant for folks who have never heard the word Web3, never heard the word NFTs. It's super friendly. It's super light. It's a lot of us talking about our own personal obstacles and challenges in our career, in our personal life, and then how we entered this wild space, why we love it, why we're passionate about it. And then the big part of it is, okay, you know, how do we empower actors? How do we empower musicians? How do we empower creators to build a community, to monetize that community, so you don't need to go work for the man? You can have 100 or 1,000 super fans, and you can live a very, very comfortable life, and you can create art, and you can monetize that forever. So kind of that was the jumping point off for the book. And then, you know, really part of that process was, okay, I was on the SAG board for 5 years. And as you said, you know, it's like unions can swing both ways in terms of what they can offer. But here we are as creators.
And sorry to cut you off.
No, please.
But the other concern that comes to mind when I think about this whole thing is, you know, SAG seemed to have failed the actors in a lot of ways, and a lot of unions seem to not.
I was going to say all the unions.
Yeah,
and a lot of the unions don't seem to represent the people that are under them in a way that really makes sense for them to even exist. So I'm wondering what makes this different, and why do you think pushing in this direction makes sense?
Well, great question. And just quick side note: when I was on the board, we were really against SAG and AFTRA coming together.
Yeah,
and I'll tell you why. AFTRA, which is another union, which now we're part of, they were undercutting Screen Actors Guild. So they would go to producers and studios and say, we'll do the work for less. You don't go through SAG, come through us. And SAG never fought that, unfortunately. And then these unions merged, and like it's been a race to the bottom. So
why would they merge?
Because
if they were undercut, was that SAG coming into the picture to say, stop undercutting?
Yes,
we'll just
exactly.
Buy you.
And AFTRA wanted to merge, and because a union is very political, right? So our team was very much against the merger, very much against it, and we lost.
Well, and I'm sure,
yeah,
and I'm sure you weren't happy about the fact that you were able to buy into AFTRA as a union.
Exactly.
And then right before the merge, there were all of these people that said, you know what, I'm not going to put in the time to get my waivers and to go and actually build my resume so that I can be a part of SAG and earn it, but I'm going to buy into AFTRA.
Right.
The unions are going to merge.
Immediately.
And now I'm going to be SAG.
Yeah, right. You know how, like, it used to be a privilege.
Is that what you did, David?
I wish I did
that. Yeah,
yeah. I missed the boat.
It used to be a privilege and an honor to be a SAG member and very hard to become one. And then suddenly AFTER made it incredibly simple. So I've seen like how unions can be great. I mean, thank God I have the SAG. Otherwise, they'd pay me nothing. You know, studios would pay nothing. But then obviously there's a lot of problems as well. So the question which you brought up, great, is, okay, as creators, as folks who are making art, as making film, you know, do making NFTs, freelancers, all of us, how do we come together and mandate that we have some type of floor scale that we receive, that we get health insurance, that we get pension, that we are able to collaborate and work together? And that, candidly, we're figuring out, because I don't think we have the silver bullet answer right now. But I think the first part of the conversation, which you put out earlier, is putting that conversation out there. Just, you know, talking about it. And then as we are in a room and the more conversations we have, figuring out exactly what that structure looks like so that we all win. And there's not, you know, we're not putting ourselves in a situation where it's worse. We want to get a million times better. And but the first thing is discussing it.
Yeah. Right. And I guess the greater point also is that there's really power in numbers.
Yeah.
So bringing everyone together makes it possible for this discussion to be a legitimate discussion, that maybe we can move towards a place where we are all being protected in a way that makes sense.
Well, do you think that there's any chance of NFTs or that technology, whether they call it something else in the next few years, ever making its way to the entertainment industry?
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, early in 2021, early 2022, I thought for sure.
Me too.
You know, I was like, so bullish. I was calling my entertainment attorney, all my agents. I was like, you guys got to get on board. Like, this technology is going to transform all the studios and the networks. And, you know, obviously we have a deep bear market. The market has somewhat come back. But I mean, really, if you look at like the community has shrunk tremendously. A lot of folks have kind of left. And I don't know. I mean, that's what I was on the phone with earlier on the way here. I was also talking to my friend about this, and to some degree, and she was saying that, you know, it really, like, the studios don't want to change. Why should they? Right. The networks don't want to change. They want to hoard the money. They don't want to be part of this kind of technological change at all. So I don't know whether it's going. I guess that's the answer. I hope so. I really hope so. But I don't know. I don't. My opinion is I don't think so. So we have to be the change. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have to create a studio, or we have to work with a smaller mini studio and start to integrate this technology.
Right. As Gandhi said, be the change you want to see in the world.
There
that's what
you
I
go.
Was thinking, and it went back to what you were saying, that like strength in numbers, but like you got to. We have to be able to compete.
Yeah.
At that level.
That's right.
And do a project that is that is like everyone's connected to it using technology. And it's only fair. It's what's right.
It's exactly.
It is what's right.
Right.
I think that's the most important thing that, like, pardon my language, but fuck the corporations.
Yeah.
For eating and sucking the life out of artists. Like, enough is enough. We're at the point in humanity that get what we deserve.
Absolutely.
Forever.
Yeah,
in perpetuity.
And things like that are only going to happen if people that are in some sort of a position of power take action, which is why it is so great that with, you know, your enormous resume and your extensive experience in the industry, you have stepped forward. Being someone that was on the board at SAG, you know how the ins and outs of these things work, and it makes sense for someone like you to be leading the way, and I have to say I'm grateful to you for that. 100%. I mean, that's fantastic.
I appreciate that.
When are you starting a petition, man? Like, to like the other people.
You just want something to sign, don't you?
Yeah, like, it's almost like a calling card to other artists that are at that same level that need to be educated. I think that's what it comes down to a lot of the time, is education. Mm-hmm. And that's probably goes to
the calling card is the book. Yeah.
And I was about to say that goes back to your book.
It's true. The book is a big calling card, and that's a great idea in terms of a petition. And I think, you know, truthfully, it's like figuring out exactly what it is, that structure of how we can all come together and make sure that we are all taken care of and celebrated and realistically like can earn a living and a good living as we deserve. And as we kind of talked about, maybe that petition initially is, okay, let's get together and start having these conversations. Because when you look at Screen Actors Guild back in the day when it was formulated, it was just like 15 actors that came together and said, okay, we've had enough. Like, our wages and working conditions have to be safe. Like, you know, we're getting screwed by the studios. We need to figure this out. And that's kind of how it was. I mean, look at the formation of this country, right? I mean, that's just kind of how it is. It's like people come together, they have some community meetings, and they're like, fuck, we need to make some changes.
Yes. And then they become the corporations they despise, right. And someone else steps up to try to take them down. It's a circle. Beautiful cycle.
Right? But with this technology, we have the opportunity. We never had smart contracts before.
Right.
We never had NFTs. And so this is like, and even AI, if we can use it in the right way, this is transformative. I was just up at CES, which I think we talked about in Vegas a couple days ago, and I heard Mark Cuban talk, and he was really saying how it's true. Like, AI is the new industrial revolution.
Yeah.
You know, it is so powerful, and it's very, from an artist's perspective, I find it to be very scary and very exciting.
Yes.
And
it's simultaneously empowering and horrifying.
Yeah.
I mean, it can put you out of work, but it can also give you another kind of a job.
Exactly. So, I mean, I literally,
it's a tool.
If you can harness the tool, you can crush it, and you can use it as a virtual assistant. You can 10x your productivity, but then at the same time, it can cobble together a bunch of different voices, and then suddenly they don't need to hire you because they've got this AI machine that sounds just as good, if not better, than you.
But here's the problem, man. I'm still finding out that there's functionality on my fucking iPhone that I had no idea about. So, like,
that is true.
You know, and I look at some of this AI stuff, and I'm like, man, there's so many thoughts that are running through my head of how this can be so great for me, and I don't know how to do any of it. And I know that's just a matter of, like, doing the research and starting somewhere.
Yeah.
But it does seem a little daunting, you know?
Get the Meta glasses, put them on, and be like, look at your phone and be like, what is this?
Yeah, have the AI assist me in learning the phone. That's the first step.
Yeah, by the way, when are we doing a MetaQuest 3 episode?
Right.
Oh, I've
actually been thinking about that.
That would be so rad.
Oh, dude, especially.
We can, like, screen record what the people see, and we can do, like, a whole little montage.
That's amazing.
Well, I love the idea of, you know, I was over at Dave's house, and he showed me the device for the first time, and one of the games he had was this thing where you walk a plank. And you're on top of an animated skyscraper, and it's just like, it's fake, but you still have this fear about you that you don't want to walk off the edge. And the point is that you're supposed to walk off the edge and fall to your death.
No!
And you just, like, look up at the building.
Oh my god, I'm terrified of heights. Dude, is it scary?
It's very horrifying. But I think that would be great to throw that on the guest's head and to have a video of them, like, not sure if they want to walk off the edge.
I should have brought it.
That's
my bad.
That's all right.
That's going to be
for sure.
Yeah.
That is cool.
But, okay, so I mentioned a little bit about your resume. I want to kind of dive into some of the things you've done. You started off by doing the Hey Arnold voice, which, I mean, so fucking cool that you're on Hey Arnold.
One of my favorite cartoons.
Oh, that's awesome.
Mine too.
Yeah. Thank you.
And one of my other favorites was Recess. Oh, and the idea that you were on both of those shows is absolutely, you were my childhood.
Gelman, King Bob's henchman. Nobody fuck with King Bob on the playground.
Well, yeah. I wanted to ask, that was
my job. I was the bodyguard.
Yeah. Right. But I wanted to ask you about that because I'm a little concerned. We've got Correo or Corio, we've got Gelman, we've got Harold, all bullies.
Oh yeah.
Were you a bully as a kid?
Not at all. I was bullied.
Does David seem like a bully?
Yeah,
he doesn't, which is why I'm wondering,
is he living vicariously through these guys?
I think playing a bully is fun. Playing the villain is so much more fun than playing the hero. You really get to get down. And there was a cartoon I did called Life with Louie. It was on Fox. We did 2 seasons. Remember Louie Anderson, the comedian?
Yeah. Yeah.
He was hilarious.
Oh, it was a great show.
I used to love going in after Louie because he would have a craft service spread of meats and cheeses because he was a big dude and he loved to eat. And I would just go in there. I would go in there after and just eat all the scraps. I'd tell my agent, book me right after Louie. And he was the best. And I used to play on that character, on that show, I played 2 characters. I played Louie's best friend, Grunewald, and then I played the bully, Glenn. And sometimes Grunewald and Glenn would get into it, and I would do the conversation back and forth with myself, which was awesome.
Which is such an impressive thing to do. You know, I've seen Regina King do it for the Boondocks back to back, and that is such an amazing talent.
It's really fun to be able to switch back and forth.
Now, that kind of brings me to my next question about the recording process. Did you find yourself in a booth alone a lot for those recordings, or were you with the rest of the cast? Did you get to interact with Arnold and Helga and those things?
That's a great question. So usually for cartoons, they bring us in individually. You know, you do your lines with the director and the producer and the sound engineer behind the booth and a couple other folks, and you're in and out in 20 minutes. You read the whole script, you do
if
your lines.
Good. If you're good.
If you're good, yeah. So usually 10 minutes.
If you can deliver.
You know, but I mean, yeah, a big part, maybe 20 or 30 minutes, and you're out. for Harold, for Hey Arnold, what we did, Craig Bartlett, who was the creator, who's, you know, brilliant. Craig is phenomenal. He would bring us all in, the entire cast, and we would read the script from top to bottom once. And that's when we would kind of start to really get into character and figure out kind of the moments that we would want to play. And then we would read the script again. And that's when it really came alive. And I actually, big shout out to Craig and the whole cast. It was so much fun. I mean, we were there for 4 hours. So, you know, 20 minutes beats 4 hours. But at the same time, I feel like that was one of the reasons why the show just popped so much. And it really brought the show to life because we were able to improvise in between little moments between us. And just kind of having the other actors in the room to play off of was phenomenal.
So you're kind of touching on this, but I guess rewrites came out of those sessions, though.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Rewrites, okay. And they allowed for a little bit of us to play and improvise, like, Madam Fortress, Mommy! That just was, you know, came out in a moment.
You must have had so much fun on that show.
Oh, yeah. I had
love
a blast.
That when the people in power, so to speak, give the artists their playground to,
yes,
go, like, create. And I think that those are the best directors and best, like, people that don't hold it so close and tight. So, like,
for sure. Great point.
It's important.
Well, Craig played one of the voices on the show. He's a singer. He plays music. So he's a real artist at heart. You know, he was an animator. And so folks like that who really are artists want to celebrate other artists,
yeah,
and make sure that we all have our voice and be part of the process, which is great. And you have some folks who are just brilliant writers who are never going to, you know, just write. And that's fine, too. But when you're actually in the room playing with the other kids, we're all playing in a sandbox, then you want other people to really kind of thrive.
Yeah, and there is something about, you know, it's one thing to come up with a joke off the top of your head when you're alone in the booth, but there's something about making the other actor, improviser, comedian laugh.
Oh, for sure.
And getting
it,
that,
like,
kick out of them, and it does validate what you're doing, and, like, then it becomes this repartee of, like, oh, you brought it up to this level, I'm going to bring it up to this level, and it just makes things so much better.
I'll tell you what, actually, it reminds me of something great. So as a voiceover actor, a lot of times, not at all now, because we record everything remotely from home, all the auditions.
No kidding.
Yeah,
so
we never go into the agency.
Okay.
We never go into the casting director's office, which kind of sucks because, like, you're just sitting there in your booth and you got to direct yourself and play it back, and then you send it over to your agent, who then sends it over to the casting or the producer.
Does your agent give you notes? Ever?
No, very rarely.
And
so
there used to be a bit of schmoozing that happened between the actor and the casting director, and maybe you could get the
exactly. No, I mean, that's what you loved it, because even if you didn't get the part, you created that relationship with the casting director, so they would think of you for the next gig.
Exactly.
So you miss a lot of that, but also, so when we used to go into the agents, you know, lobby, and we would wait to go in an audition, you know, we'd be in there for 30, 45 minutes. Dude, the schmoozing and the cracking up and the kind of joke topping that would happen amongst, because a lot of voiceover talent are either stand-ups or they're improvisers. I mean, you got to be one of the two, unless you're just naturally really talented. So it was a riot. I mean, you'd be there at 10 o'clock in the morning, freaking laughing, crying your eyes out as some comedian is attacking the other one. They're going after, then they're picking out somebody else the rube to rub, and everybody's in on it. And I mean, it's hilarious.
I feel like a mockumentary style show about,
yes,
voiceover artists. There's something there.
There totally is something there.
Yeah.
There really is, for sure. It was a riot.
So you were voicing these characters a little bit later in your career. I'm interested, you know, we have Erie and Deanna back here on the,
yes,
screen. When you were a kid, that's you on my right, maybe the audience is,
damn, I was cute, wasn't I?
So cute.
Woo! What happened to me?
But, well, you know, I was wondering that. You know, you're going for facials this morning, I understand, to try to get yourself all tight and back to, you don't want to look like Harold the Bully.
That's right. I am going for a facial. I'm not giving a facial. And, yes, I have a fabulous facialist that I see once every 3 months.
Yep, that's why we came in early today, to accommodate your schedule. Make sure
I also asked for her phone number.
You cannot even make this shit up.
No,
I'm
you
actually
can't.
Going for a facial.
This is very Hollywood of you.
I am the true Hollywood story. Did you ever watch Along Came Polly?
I did.
Remember,
yes,
that when Philip Seymour Hoffman rents the I mean, that is,
dude,
one of the brilliant
movie.
Moments ever.
His character in that film in
genius.
General. I was actually shooting some hoops last night, yeah, at the arcade with a buddy of mine, and I was going, make it rain.
I loved him.
Iconic character.
Brilliant.
So cool.
Brilliant.
So Erie, Indiana, that's kind of when you were a kid. It was, you know, it's a show that I vaguely remember, and I didn't realize I remembered it until I looked at the picture of you as a kid. Yeah. And I'm like, holy shit, yeah. I've watched that show.
Awesome.
And it was like a precursor to Stranger Things almost.
Very much so. In fact, of all the projects I've ever worked on, and I'm so lucky to work, I'm very grateful, Erie was my favorite of all time. I was 11 years old. I had booked this part. So let me just tell you the audition process. I had to have 12 auditions to get this job.
Whose idea was it for you to be an actor? Was it your parents pushing you as a kid, or was that something
you were
dying to do?
Yeah, they were like, somebody's got to fucking make some money in this family. Get the kid to work.
He's got to pay rent.
Somebody's got to earn. Who's going to pay for his college? No, that my parents had a bakery in Palos Verdes, and customers would come in because I was cute when I was back then, and they were like, oh, your kid's cute. Get him an agency if he likes it. And that's what they did, and I loved it. It was a lot of fun. But when I did Erie, you know, it was like this kind of X-Files for kids. And so they would have these fog machines. We'd be crawling through the fog. We had a little cubby house where we kept all our clues. So it was like a kid's dream. There was one episode where I went to the ATM machine and it kept spitting out cash. So I was able to run a limousine and have unlimited amounts of ice cream. I mean, it was crazy. I was 11.
Oh my God.
I was like in heaven.
Dream come true.
Yeah. So Erie was the precursor to Stranger Things. It was an amazing show. Chris Carter, who was the creator of X-Files, used to come to set all the time. He loved Erie. And it was a dream to work on. I've always wanted to bring Erie back. So Lionsgate, if you're listening, and Hearst Entertainment, come on, let's get it going. We have some great ideas for the show. Let's bring Erie back.
We've got some fantastic talent here. If you need some, extra parts.
That's right. We got a great cast right here.
That's right. So was that the first like major thing that you booked?
That was the first thing. So usually the way it starts in an actor's career, and you know, it's always, there's no formula for actors, right? But typically, and I kind of very much followed this, it was like commercials initially. So the first gig I got, I was 6 years old, was for a Mattel commercial. They put me in a harness. I was flying around in this harness, it like for a toy commercial. And then they had this craft service with unlimited amounts of candy and cookies. I was like, this is it.
Okay,
so I get a fly and I got cookies and candy. I'm done.
as much as we made jokes about your parents wanting you to earn a living,
yeah.
You know, while by the time you got to the Erie auditions, that may have been, you know, something that you were really desiring at 6 years old.
Oh, yeah.
This acting career couldn't have been your idea.
For sure. No, at six, like, it wasn't, right? It was like my parents were like, hey, the kid seems to like it. He's making some shekels.
Right.
Let's get him to do some more.
Right.
But no, it was fun. I was in acting class with Joey Gordon-Levitt. You know, I was taking improv as a kid, which was fun, and doing commercials. So I did probably like 50 commercials, a lot of commercials. Then I started doing guest appearances on TV shows. I did Fresh Prince of Bel-Air.
Oh, wow.
I don't know if you ever watched it. I was in the episode with Evander Holyfield when he had just won the heavyweight title. He shows up to set. He's in a full black leather suit. I'm like, damn, that man is cool. And this is like Will Smith was the star, but he wasn't a celebrity. He was like the star of this TV show. And yeah, my character came. We knocked on the door and I said, you know, we can see your lights from the freeway. Because they had a bunch of Christmas lights. So that was fun.
That's awesome. I do remember that, actually.
So I did Fresh Prince. I did a bunch of guest appearances on shows. Then I started to do reoccurring, where you do like a few episodes for a series. And then my first major gig was for Erie. And I had to go in and audition 12 times.
Wow.
Which was crazy. 12 auditions. Casting, directors, producers, numerous times. Then you have to go to, I had to go to the studio. That's what they call the money people. Those are the people that are putting in the money for the show. Once they approve you, then you have to go to network.
Was that insanely overwhelming as a kid?
Yeah, it was like stressful as an 11-year-old.
Did you ask them why they couldn't film it and just press play 12 times?
I should have, but no, I didn't at that point because I was very demanding. I wanted caviar after every audition.
Yeah. That's right. you were very familiar with the craft services table,
right.
And you knew what you wanted.
I was like,
on
if this series doesn't have smoothies and strawberry banana smoothies,
I'm not doing
and
it.
Caviar and sushi, I'm not into it.
I'm out of here. I think it's really cool that your parents supported that.
Yes, I was very lucky.
I think that not a ton of parents would be doing that for
their
kids.
A lot. It's
like,
a lot.
Believe it. Yeah,
so. A lot of work on my mom, who was schlepping me to auditions and taking me to acting class. Is a lot. I mean, the traffic in LA is crazy.
Yeah.
So, and she was also really focused on education for me. So I was always in regular school. I personally am not a believer in homeschooling. I don't think it's good for kids. I think the kids, you know,
I was homeschooled.
Oh shit. Well,
no,
you know,
this
is why you are the way you are.
That's true.
No, I mean, look, some kids turn out great, but kids need to be in regular school with regular kids. They got to be doing regular activities. They got to get bullied. They got to deal with the regular
their
stuff.
Communities.
Yeah.
Everything. There's a lot of things things that you talked about, even at with acting being in the sandbox with, you know, and that goes back to community.
Right.
That goes back to your book. And I think a big thing about Web3 and everything that we're doing is community.
Yes.
As artists is like we talked about it the other day while we were here, that it's so important for artists to have other people that actually believe in what they're doing.
Definitely.
And I think it's lost a lot of times in here in Los Angeles.
It is. It is because, you know, I mean, people come here from all around the world to make it. It's such a brutal business.
City of transplants.
Yeah. I mean, really very, very few people end up making it where they can make a living or, you know, it reach tremendous heights. And, you know, it's almost like a mercenary thing. Like very, very few people make it. The folks that do make it can be highly narcissistic and they're off on their own. They're doing their own thing and God bless them. They make it. But, you know, as artists, like, we need to celebrate each other. We need to support each other. And I don't think the business is set up that way. It was never set up that way. In fact, I almost think the studio system of lore, you know, back in the 40s was much more that way, when you'd get like that 2-year contract and you go work for MGM and they would, you'd go every day and they'd put you in acting class and they'd put you in dance class and singing class. And then they put you in that movie and you would all work together and you were like a traveling circus, but you were a community. Mm-hmm. And then when you weren't on the movie, you were, you know, back there every day. We're, as freelancers, you know, we go from job to job. We're it's a feast and famine kind of business.
Operating
it's hard.
In silos.
Yeah, very yeah. silos. Yeah. Very, very siloed. And it's antithetical to what artists are, which is very community, very supportive, want each other to win. And as one person wins, we reach and help the other folk to win. And that's not the way the business is set up.
Right. Which is difficult because in life, that's hard for people too. Sometimes when you know, in general, as humans, when we see someone succeeding, some of us want to glorify that person, uplift them and praise them for the work that they've done. And others want to bring that person down.
Yeah. Right.
And say, you know, they shouldn't be up there. I should be up there or something of that nature. And
exactly.
Bring them down a few pegs. So I'm kind of curious, when you started to see this success through Erie, did other kids give you a hard time or were they good to you? About it.
No, you know, it's interesting. So it was a mixed bag. But so I did Erie for a year, and then I went immediately on a show called Picket Fences for 4.5 years. So it's like Erie got canceled after one season, which was a bummer. And the only reason was because
a lot of episodes for one season.
We did
right?
We did 22,
yeah,
which is how you know network TV used to be, which is how it's great. Now they do 6 or 8, which
right.
sucks.
Yeah.
So we got canceled because the president of NBC got fired. They brought in a new president, and then when that happens, they end up canceling a lot of the shows because that guy wants or woman wants to bring in their own shows.
Right.
And that's kind of where we unfortunately got lost. But I went right to Picket, and so for Erie, I was kind of starting to watch the show a little bit. The kids at school thought that was cool and fun, and they were super nice. And then on Picket Fences, like, kids started to become mean. They become, like, super jealous. They kept asking me, like, how much money do you make per week? You know, why are you leaving? What are you doing? Why do you think you're better than everybody? And I was kind of like a nerdy kid. So it was hard. It was difficult.
Were you able to maintain a regular school schedule? Or were you, because of the television shows, kind of coming in and out as you pleased sort of thing, and maybe that was a little bit of the resentment?
Well, it could have been. I mean, you know, on Picket Fences, it was an hour show. Erie, we were a half hour show, and I was kind of one of the leads, so I was on set every day. And so I had to have a tutor every day, and then when we were off, I would go back to regular school. But on Picket Fences, it was a 7-day shoot, meaning we wouldn't shoot on the weekend, so we'd shoot Monday to Friday, and then Monday to Tuesday of the following week would still be that same episode. Then a new episode would start on Wednesday to, you know, whatever. And so on an hour show, you only have to be on set the days that you're working. So I had a smaller part. So I usually, in a 7-day shoot, I had about 2 or 3 days, maybe 4 days, when I would be on set. The other days, I was just in normal school.
Right, right. And I mean, look, I just every kid, well, maybe not every kid, but a lot of kids have that dream of like, oh, it would be really cool to do that. So there's just going to be natural resentment anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
Because that's the lifestyle that everyone
wants. And kids are mean.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, kids are just normally mean.
Well, but also, I mean, you're talking about like an episode where you get to like drive around a limo and eat ice cream. Like,
right.
You're living the dream for a kid.
That
man.
Is true. I cannot complain. I was living the dream.
So at what point do you decide, like, okay, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life? Was it right off the bat when you were doing these shows, you were like, I don't want to do anything else? Or were you, as kids do, kind of like, you know, still of the mind of like, I want to be an astronaut or I want to do this or that? And had that, like, that sense of, oh, maybe there's something that I haven't messed with that I want my life to be?
That's a great question. I don't think I ever really determined, okay, I want to continue always being an actor as an adult when I was kind of a teenager. I always thought about, I want to explore other things. I want to explore other things in the business, whether it's producing or writing or directing, and maybe even being a lawyer outside of the business or doing something that's kind of more traditional. I just wasn't quite sure what it was going to be. And I think even post-college, I came back down and was dabbling in acting. That was kind of when the reality movement was taking off. It was like early 2000s. So like Survivor, it was a tough time to be in the business because it was all reality all the time. So I was always kind of dabbling in other things. But yeah, it just kind of was just natural. It just felt, I loved it. I love being on set. And as we talked about, like, I love working with other creatives. That is the most fun, when you really are in your flow state and you're really just jiving with somebody else and you're listening and you're responding. It's a special, special thing. And if you get to get paid to be able to do that, it's like a gift.
Yeah, absolutely. So I saw on your resume that you've done a little bit of producing as well.
Mm-hmm.
So do you like the back end of things, or does it get frustrating for you because there's a lot of red tape, so to speak? Even if you're the head of production, you know, there's so much that you have to figure out. There's so much stress involved in getting a production together. There are so many personalities you have to deal with. I mean, did it become a thing where, like, you know what? This is too maddening. And I would just rather lean back into this thing of acting and creating. That feels a little bit better.
You hit the nail on the head. I mean, from one aspect of acting, like, I feel there's a little bit of helplessness in, because you're on set, you're in your trailer, they call you, you go on set, you do your thing, you go back in your trailer, right? And that's great. But there's also an aspect of me where I want to be in control, and I want to be part of the process, and I want to hire the writer, and I want to be part of the development. So that whole aspect I love. Like, okay, what's the kernel of the idea, and see it all the way through to the fruition of the project and post-production. And you get to work with all these talented folks. You get to work with the composer, and you get to work with, you hire the talent, and it's so cool. And then you're out there marketing and pushing and getting the project out so many people could see it. But at the same time, once you go through that process, you're like, fuck it, man. I just want to be an actor. Like, it's so easy just being in the trailer and being called and do your lines and you're out. Because it's, you know, both of them have pros and cons. And I'm actually right now in development for a pilot that I wrote that I'm producing. And I'm, as you were talking, I'm like, gosh, it is a lot of work.
Yeah.
I wish somebody would just take that hat on and wear it and let me just show up and be, smile and do my thing. Because it's a ton of work. I mean, look, even setting up the show for today, you have, you know, your camera set up, you've got everything, you've got all this stuff, you got the keyboard, you've got everything set up. I mean, it's a lot of work to put this stuff together.
Totally. Well, yeah, you know, I was going to kind of say, when you're starting out, you're a little bit grassroots, you kind of have to be a producer to a certain respect if you want your stuff to get out there. So
important,
you know,
yes.
To know how to communicate with other people on the set.
Absolutely.
So, like, going and doing those jobs, and, like, producing is probably having the knowledge of every department, or at least some of the language to communicate with everybody. So hats off to you for having that.
Yeah,
thank you.
And I mean, you know, we have ambitions that correlate to the industry. Dave here is an amazing editor, director of photography, wants to do some directing. I love to act. I think you want to do a bit of acting.
Yep,
I love to direct.
I've done a couple things here and there. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
Nice.
And you know, we've found ourselves in a position where, okay, we are creatives that love the film industry. We want to be a part of it. But to start out, we need to be producing our own stuff. So
totally.
We did a short film that's in the festival circuit right now. We're ramping
awesome.
Up for another one.
Awesome.
But it is so much work. And you see why a lot of people don't continue in this
industry.
Oh,
it's brutal.
Because you really have to love it.
That's something I was going to touch on, actually,
yeah.
to shout you out, is that, you know, you went and did other things and stuck with the industry as well. So
yeah.
I think, like, going to college, especially as a child actor, is so important to go get your education, like, live a little bit of a normal life and not get lost in the industry. So I think that's like a big, you know, shout out to you for that. And not easy to do. I don't think it's easy to not get lost in the
Thank
industry.
You. I appreciate that.
Kid.
Yeah, no, I, when I was on the board of SAG, and I always, when I talk to, like, young actors, I always focus on education for them.
Totally.
Because, I mean, look, the business is really brutal. It's very hard. It's very hard to make a living. And I also feel, especially as an actor and all artists, the more you can draw on real life, in the characters that you create, the more fulfilling and rich those characters are going to be.
Absolutely.
So if you go to college, if you travel, if you experience life as a child, as an adult, as a young adult, that's going to make your art so much richer.
Oh, yeah. The more life you live, the more experiences you'll have to draw on. Absolutely. Without question.
So I am, you know, I'm a big believer in that. I always tell kids, like, you know, acting is amazing. And you can, the great thing is you can do it till you're 100. Yeah. There isn't, you know, there's no retirement. So get your college degree, do as much as you want. And it's always going to be here. And obviously you got to be super passionate about it. And I love the way you guys are tackling it. You know, you're here, you're doing it, you're producing, you got your show, you're producing short films. And, you know, the folks that I really respect who we see who are a lot of the A-list talent, they would never be there if they hadn't done their own work. Yep, I mean, right. I worked on a, it's funny, quick anecdote. I got called in years ago. I think I was like 16, and my agent called and said, Gus Van Sant is directing this new movie. And Gus Van Sant, I was a big
my
fan
own
of.
Private Idaho.
Well, right. It was the Damon Affleck film, okay. Which, what's the name of it?
Goodwill Hunting.
Goodwill Hunting. So I get called into, we were at Warner Brothers, and it was just to do some voiceover, some ADR in one of the scenes. So there was like six actors. Gus called in. We did some auditions. He immediately hired us on the spot. We go into the room. It was myself and Eric Von Detten, who I don't think Eric works anymore, but he used to work a lot. And in the room, we see the scene, and we're like, it's the basketball scene, and we're egging on. We're like calling names and, you know, trashing each other. And Affleck and Damon are there. I didn't know who they were because I hadn't seen Mallrats or anything. And Damon comes up to me and he says, hey, you know, thanks so much for coming in. I thought they were PAs. I literally thought they were PAs. They looked so young and they were wearing white T-shirts and jeans. So I thought they were PAs. And
you're like, yeah, where's the craft services table?
Well, no. What he said to me, he's like, hey, you know, thanks so much for coming in. Can I get you anything? I was like, yeah, a cappuccino would be great.
Oh, my God.
So Damon goes and gets me a cappuccino. And I'm like, oh, what a sweet PA. Like, the guy's so nice. So I'm sitting there having my cappuccino. I'm watching the scene. I don't recognize them because they look different. I'm in and out of there in an hour. Then, lo and behold, 6 months later, what the hell?
That's the guy.
They got me the cappuccino.
And you're like, hey, that barista's a pretty good actor.
Right. Man.
You got lucky on that set.
You know, it's like, those guys made it because they did that film. They'd never be where they are if that hadn't happened. And so many other talented actors produced their own shorts, you know, got their films made, like scrapped whatever had to get done to make it happen. It's either, I kind of look at it, it's like either nepotism, you're either the son or daughter of somebody famous, and then you kind of are easily represented at CAA or WME, and you get your shot that way. You scrapped, you got the audition, you got the part, and you kind of worked your way up that way. Or, more than likely, like you make your own film, it gets in a Sundance, or some studio buys it, and suddenly you're huge. I mean, Vince Vaughn, Jon Favreau, Matt Damon, Ben Affleck, and that's just the beginning list of probably 30 of the top folks out there did it because they did it their own way, and especially directors, right? So what you guys are doing, that's inspiring to me, and that's the way to do it.
Appreciate that, man. And what I really love about that story also is, you know, we were just cutting up a retrospective of all of our shows from the past year. One of the clips that we're going to wind up using is from this film composer, Greg Reverett, who's a wonderful guy. Mm-hmm. And one of the things he was talking about was, if you want to succeed in the industry, it's also about being humble.
Mm-hmm. Easy Dave length.
Yeah, I know you were probably thinking the same thing.
Say,
yeah,
like, can you go get a cup of coffee?
Right.
And I was going to shout out to Damon as well.
That's why I brought it up. It's totally. The fact that he didn't try to tell you, oh, you know who I am,
right,
or anything like that.
This is my movie. Go talk to the fucking
right. Right. Totally. He went and got you the fucking cappuccino, and that's awesome.
Yeah. For sure. No, I agree. It's like this. You know, this business is so competitive and so tough that I think if you are a schmuck, then you're going to kind of get lost. You've got to be humble. You've got to realize really how grateful you should be to get work because it's so freaking hard and everybody wants to do it, so that when you do make it, you know, you have to realize, hey, it could be gone in a second, in a fleeting Absolutely. Second. I told you that Jim Carrey story, right?
No, I don't think so.
So when I was working on Picket Fences, Lauren Holly, who was on the show,
who played Jim Carrey's love interest
in Dumb and Dumber. Yeah, and then they got married.
Yep.
They got married. So Jim would come to Picket Fences all the time. He'd come to set. Sweetest guy ever. So humble, hilarious, like a doll. So we were up for a bunch of Emmys and Golden Globes, so we went to the Emmys one year, and after the after party was at Spago's, when Spago's used to be up in the Hollywood Hills. So Jim is there, And I take a photo with Jim and Lauren, and he's like, hey, you want me to sign this for you? I'm like, yeah, that'd be cool. So a week later in the mail, I get this photo. It's Jim, Lauren, and myself, and it says, "Dear Justin, you are obviously quite drunk in this photo. Your buddy Jim."
Now, awesome.
Mind you, I was 16, and obviously, I wasn't drinking anything.
Right,
dude, he was hilarious. Like, just
so funny.
An amazing, amazing guy, incredibly talented, genius talent, but very humble. So it goes to what you were saying.
Absolutely.
It's yeah. Awesome.
Well, we're pushing awesome. Up on like 12:06 right now. I want to let you get to your facial.
I got to get to my facial.
I got to get to your facial.
I do
it's
have
very
one,
important.
One thing to ask you.
Yes. Oh, I was going to wrap it up with one more question, but
because,
you go first.
Well, I think a big goal of this show for me is to inspire the people that are watching and like the artists that don't think that they're worthy to continue.
Mm-hmm.
So like what is a piece of advice that you would have for those people that are, you know, in their own head, they have a lot of talent, but they don't know where to start. What do you say to them?
And let me just piggyback off of that because that almost ties into my question, which
easy,
was, would you even tell them to start? Because one of the last things you touched on was how hard this industry can be. We're talking about you putting together some sort of unionization so people can be properly taken care of because they're not right now. Would you even tell people to get involved in this whole rigmarole?
Great questions, Dave and Dave. Thank you. I'd say, you know what? First of all, always yes. The answer is always yes. Go for it. Live your dreams. Make
it
happen.
Do your own research, but yeah. Get involved.
Do it. But even now, the great thing is with Web3 and NFTs, you know, I used to say, okay, you realistically, you got to be in LA, New York, Chicago, Atlanta. Those are kind of the bigger markets. If you're in the US and in, around the world, you know, you could be in London or Sydney. But you have to be in those markets to really, if you want to have a shot, because this is where kind of the production is happening. But nowadays, you know, you can be in your mom's basement, no pun intended, in Iowa or in, you know, wherever you are around the world and make your art and put it out on the internet, put it out on YouTube, put it out on Twitter or X and start to build a community. And organically from that, you can really start to make a name for yourself. So I'm so inspired by the opportunity now with Web3 and NFTs to decentralize creators around the world to harness. And yes, look, we all have that negative snake in our mind that's telling us we're not good enough. We're never going to make it. You know, we got to go do something else. And then folks in our life who are like, why are you still doing that? You should just go get a regular job. You know, it's just you're wasting your life away. Every year it gets harder. Yeah. Everybody has that all the time. Just continue. Just do it. Do it. Do it. It's brutal.
Hard.
It's brutal.
So hard.
But just continue. And actually, Seth Rogen, I saw him say something recently, and I did work on.
I saw that same thing. Yep.
I worked on 40-Year-Old Virgin with him, and he was he's hilarious. And
I just watched that the other day, and like, it's so good. I
it's hysterical.
How good it was.
That movie is freaking funny as hell.
You just plant a bunch of seeds, and then the seeds grow into a plant, and you fuck that plant.
That's dude. That you got the voice. You can nail him. And he was like, just don't give up.
Yeah, because the people that succeed don't quit.
You can't quit because you know the industry naturally gets smaller because people stay for a few years, they realize how brutal it is, and then they end up moving back to typically where they're from because it's like a tough business and it's hard to make a living and it's just it sucks the soul out of you. But if you continue fighting and you continue showing up every day and just getting an inch closer, and even if you get hit back in the head numerous times, you go backwards and you keep going forward, just continue. And the ones that don't give up, and you'll make it. You will make it. You may be 99 and a half, but you're going to make it.
Yeah. Two steps forward and one step back.
That's it.
And when you say you might be 99, that's also one of those things where they say you really have to enjoy the process
as
well.
Absolutely.
And this whole thing is a journey.
It's not the destination. It's the journey. Being
Absolutely.
Here, it's part of the process. This is part of the love of doing it. This is part of the process.
Absolutely. Well, I cannot thank you. Well, we cannot thank you enough for being here today.
Totally.
This was so cool. Everyone should go and check out The Future of Community. It's in stores everywhere. You can grab it on Amazon. You can grab it at Target.
Barnes and Noble.
So go out and grab a copy. I'm definitely going to be reading that. Can't wait to see some of the great things that you're bringing to the public about why we should be protected as creators and why we should have a place in this world, really. You are an inspiration.
Oh, please.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. This was an honor being with the Davids. And anytime, I love, well, you guys, I mean, your mission, we all align. We're all artists. We're building this together. We want to celebrate artists and we want to make sure that we all can eat and feast. It's our time to feast.
Yes.
And this is great. And I love the art department. So shout out. Everybody, come be part of this community. It's freaking awesome. We're building it together.
That's right.
All right, we love you, man. Thank you very much.
Thank you to our beautiful audience for being here on another beautiful Saturday. We hope you'll join us next Saturday for another episode of Sapo Studios Scratch Track Saturdays. Have a wonderful rest of your weekend, a wonderful week. Sapo Studios out.
Hey everybody, this is Harold from Hey Arnold, and you're watching Sapo TV. You better watch it, or I'll pound you. Ha 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 ha.
That's probably the one he is.